You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Bio 190. Hopefully everybody knows my name is Kira Mathis and I am the instructor for the Bio 190 class. I'm sad to say that we only have a couple of classes left, so we will be wrapping up here in the next few weeks. Our last class is December 4th. Just to remind everybody, still doing quizzes and discussion boards. I'll have those up for you by the end of the day or tomorrow morning at the latest. And today we're going to be talking about the deep sea, which is kind of this abstract thinking or thought process, because it's somewhere that, of course, no one really ever gets to, which we'll talk about in a little bit. But other things coming up. I do want to remind everybody that you have your conservation paper that is going to be due at the end of the semester, December 4th, at the end of the day. So hopefully everybody has started to work on that. If you have any questions, please make sure you email me at kmathis@lbaop.org. Again, that's the same idea as when you uploaded the photo or the file for your field trip paper. It has to be uploaded in the assignment tab on Blackboard. So do not email me your papers and do not copy and paste your text into the assignment. You actually have to upload your file onto the assignment board, and you can do that by clicking on the Browse My Computer, find your file, and then upload it. It has to be a .doc or a .docx, or if you don't have those, you can also do a .rtf, so .rtf. Those are the formats that I will be able to open and read. With the field trip paper, some of you uploaded it that was not those formats, and I cannot open it. I've emailed you if I have not been able to open your file, so please make sure and email me a copy. Check your Blackboard email. That's how I got in contact with you about your paper. Real quick, also, with your conservation paper, it's really important that you put your name on your paper. A lot of you did not do that and did not put it in the file name either, so when I download those to read them, I don't know who it is. So that's putting a lot of extra work on me, so please make sure, as you would any other paper for your classes, put your name in the top left corner or right corner, I don't even care, just so I know who it is so I can give you the proper credit. Now, we are going to be doing an extra credit assignment. This will be the last one for the semester. And what I want you to do for your extra credit assignment is to think of, now that we've had three classes, think of three things that you yourself can do to help improve the environment and what you're going to do to implement those changes. So you'll be getting some extra credit points for those. You can email me that, so it's a really easy one. Just go ahead, think of those three things that you would do that are realistic, that you want to do, that are going to help to enrich our environment. It could be going to a trash cleanup, it could be carpooling, anything like that. Let me know and I'll give you some extra credit points for that. We do have our final exam. That is going to be, again, at the end of the class, so that'll be around December 4th. I'll give you more details on that, but it's very similar to the midterm. You need to have your sponsor be with you during that exam. It's going to be an hour, and there are 35 questions on the final exam. So lots of stuff to talk about. Before I forget, happy Thanksgiving. It's going to be a good week, hopefully, for everybody. I love Thanksgiving. It's one of my favorites. So anyway, happy Thanksgiving. I do not want to forget to wish everybody that. And with that, we'll go ahead and introduce Allie, who is our guest speaker today. We are not going live from the aquarium, unfortunately. We had some technical difficulties. And even our exhibits, which we'll talk about in a second, we don't really have a lot of deep sea exhibits, so we were kind of going to get a little creative with it today anyway, which we'll talk about. But anyway, Allie, thank you for joining us. I've been working with Allie since I started. She's been there at the aquarium longer than I have, so She's kind of the expert here, so she'll be helping us with deep sea. So, Allie, as we do with everybody, would you please introduce yourself and tell them a little bit about how you got here?
Sure, I'd be happy to. Hello, I'm so excited to be back on Bio 190. My name's Allie Lebeau, and I am the Teacher and School Resources Coordinator at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and that really long title means that it is my job to help make the aquarium as much of a usable resource for teachers who hope to bring marine science into their classroom. Of course, we want them to be able to visit the aquarium and bring their students to our galleries, but there are also ways that we can get into their classrooms and make sure that marine science is used as that tool for really engaging students and teaching those science concepts that we know they need to teach. I've been at the aquarium for almost 9 years now. Before that, I was an instructor out on Catalina Island with Catalina Island Marine Institute, so I went snorkeling and kayaking and had an opportunity to share the island with lots of people. And before that, I was an elementary school science teacher, so I've had lots of years of teaching kids about the ocean and the environment, and now I'm here.
Awesome. Well, glad to have you. All right, so today's topic is not so much of an elementary topic, right?
Yes.
We're going to be talking about the deep sea. Now, the deep sea is kind of an interesting place. When we think about the ocean, you know, we've talked about this in numerous discussions that most of the activity happens at the top of the ocean, mm-hmm. right? But there is a good chunk that's considered deep sea.
Yeah, I think that that's one of the most amazing things about talking about deep sea is that you're really talking about the largest habitat on the planet. I mean, the ocean overall is this enormous habitat home to such a diversity of life. But when you talk about the deep sea, you're talking about a huge amount of space that is incredibly constant, incredibly stable. And for a lot of it, there's not a lot there. There are huge challenges in getting there. There's so much that we just don't know about it. So when we talk about deep sea, it's sort of like, well, we end up with lots more questions than really answers. About 70% of the Earth is considered deep sea, of the entire Earth is considered deep sea. And I guess we can talk about how deep is, but the fact that there's so much deep sea that where not a lot of animals live is kind of interesting.
Yeah, definitely. And I think it's always interesting that we talk about how there's been more exploration of the moon mm-hmm. than there has been in the deep sea. So we can send people to space, but to try and get people down to some of our deepest parts is like unheard of,
and
right?
That it's easier to get to the moon, it's easier to get to outer space than it is to get to the parts of our own planet. It's really, really neat.
So speaking of which, the deepest part is quite a ways down there.
Yes, so the deepest part of the ocean is called the Marianas Trench, and it is about 36,000 feet deep. And what that means is that if you were to take Mount Everest and put Mount Everest in the Marianas Trench, you would still have about a mile of water above the top of the summit. So just like we have mountains and valleys and ridges and all the topography on land, we also have that under the water as well. And the Marianas Trench, as you can see in this map, is sort of off of Japan, off of the Philippines.
Pointing out right here, Pacific Ocean, right? And here we are. I mean, here's the United States. So way across the Pacific Ocean there is where we'll find Marianas Trench.
And as I said, the Marianas Trench is about 36,000 feet deep, 11,000 meters. And you might think, well, that's an extreme. That's one example that's really deep. But really, the average depth of the ocean is about 2 miles. And that's taking everything into consideration from the intertidal zone, where you can stand with just your feet wet, all the way down to the Marianas Trench. So averaging everywhere, the average depth is 2 miles. That's usually pretty shocking to people.
And that is really deep. So that's about 12,000 feet down, basically. And that's a place that, as you already mentioned, is extremely hard to mm-hmm. explore, which is one of the reasons that we know so little. And just kind of backing up, I mentioned earlier, right when we started, that we don't really have many deep sea exhibits or really anything at the aquarium because A, we don't know much, and B, we'll talk about kind of the adaptations of the animals mm-hmm. and some of the challenges that we would face in even trying to have an exhibit to demonstrate the deep sea.
Yeah, as we start to talk about deep sea exploration, and we're saying how hard it is, but it does happen. There are ships and vehicles that are especially designed to do this, but the capability to display those is really challenging. And so the science now is just still on exploration and discovery. And as marine educators, we just sort of try to show little glimpses of what those animals look like and talk about a little bit of some of those adaptations.
Right, so you'll notice today we have a lot of pictures that we're going to try and show you. We obviously don't have biofacts out here like we normally do, so it's just kind of some of the challenges, but you're going to see how amazing these animals truly are. Now, these animals, you know, we talk about how a lot of life, a lot of activity happens up in the upper zone, right? Mm-hmm. Now, with that, that also means that as you go deeper, we start to lose light. So all of this is located below the photosynthetic zone, mm-hmm. or where, you know, algae can grow and all that kind of stuff. So we also have, like you were saying, those continental ridges and mountains and stuff. What about the continental shelf? Can you explain that a little bit as far as how it drops into deep sea?
Sure. A little bit of that depends on where you are and what the shelf looks like, and the slope of that shelf is going to be sort of determined by where you are. I mean, even in the United States, the East Coast, the shelf that runs off from the East Coast is very shallow. So you can mm-hmm. be a few miles out to sea and still only be in 100, 200 feet of water. Here off of our coast, you very quickly go into very deep water. And so in the channel between us and the island, you get deep really, really quick, which is unique, and it kind of means that there are some different sets of life that you might find there.
I was going to say, I like to point out, yeah, exactly what you were saying is that it's not always same. Like, I know growing up when I was thinking of deep sea, I would think like, oh, okay, we go out and land and I remember the beach kind of drops off and then I can't touch mm-hmm. anymore, and maybe a little further out it kind of drops off, but Southern California is very unique in its topography, or like its underwater mapping and stuff. So we'll get into that. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the different zones of the ocean. So we were saying that 90%, or actually, let's bring this up. We have space on Earth and habitable space on Earth. There's this kind of cool little diagram. Here we go, to show you. If we can bring this full screen. It'll show you. So in here, if you want to touch on this a little bit, I'm just going to point out about the surface area versus mm-hmm. the volume and the deep ocean.
Yeah, this is just a great illustration of how much of the Earth's volume, so if you kind of thinking about it in a three-dimensional way, is this deep sea. And when we, you know, that one little percent is going to be land, 78% by volume is going to be that deep sea. And we've already said that most life in the ocean, about 90% of it is in that first epipelagic layer where there's photosynthesis, where there's sunlight, where we can scuba dive, where we can snorkel, where we can send exploration sort of more relatively easily. But this is just a really great illustration of there is a lot of inhabitable space on Earth that is not inhabitable. And is this deep sea. So it's a really unique habitat. And just the fact that it's so vast, so huge, so much unknown about it, and so constant is really, really amazing. In the first 200 meters of the ocean, you have all of this life, you have all this diversity, you have changes in dissolved oxygen, changes in temperature, changes in pH. You get to the deep sea, you have none of that. It's just constant. And the fact that there's not a ton of difference between 1,500 meters and 2,000 meters, all the way down to 6,000 meters, that's a huge amount of space that's just constant.
Right.
It's really, really interesting.
Let's go ahead. Let's talk about the zonation. We have a nice image here to talk about how they break down mm-hmm. these different zones. And let's kind of talk about that. So we were just talking about the epipelagic zone, right?
So
there's our top portion.
So the epipelagic is kind of like the icing on the cake, right? It's the very, very thin layer. But this is even a great graphic to think about how much life, everything that you can see at the aquarium, everything that you can probably name off the top of your head as an ocean animal, is in that epipelagic layer. And this graphic has it as the light blue, not because of really anything other than that's where photosynthesis is happening. That's where sun is penetrating. That's where you're going to find plankton. That's where plankton is doing photosynthesis. That's where there's plant life. Because of that plant life, that means where you have, that's where you have a lot of your of your animal life as well. And 200 meters, I mean, that's like, even that's pretty deep. That's down to like 600 feet. We're not scuba diving down to 600 feet. You know,
no.
We're not holding our breath down to 600 feet. So even 600 feet kind of seems deep. So most of what we sort of recognize as aquarium exhibits or animals in the ocean is just in that really, really thin layer. When you get to that next one, you get to the what we call the twilight zone or the mesopelagic, and it's a little bit lighter because there is potentially some light penetrating down. You know, it's like twilight. There's just a little bit of light, but not a ton, not
right.
really lots of photosynthesis. Once you get down to the midnight zone, the bathypelagic, that is really where you, there's no photosynthesis. It's just not happening.
It's gone.
Yep,
there's
sun's
no
not
sun.
Nope, no sun. No sun. So then you come up with a challenge. Well, wait, if there's no sun, there's no plants, the animals aren't eating plants, so how is there food? Well, that's got to come from someplace else, or they have to go get it someplace else, and we'll talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, we'll be getting into those adaptations. So that means that past the bathypelagic, abyssopelagic, and hadopelagic, no sun. So it's going to be dark, and that in itself presents a ton of challenges for the animals and mm-hmm. everything going on down there, which, of course, there are animals down there, and they only, like, recently, not like today, but found out about life down there. And we'll talk about that in the exploration in just a little bit. But for a long time, they didn't even know if life
yeah.
existed.
I think that's so interesting. Even the names are so telling. So bathypelagic means bottom layer. So for a good period of time, they thought, oh, that must be the bottom. We found the bottom. Nope, we were wrong. It turns out there's a little bit further down. Okay, abyssal pelagic. I mean, abyss, we all know what that means. Oh, no, still wrong. Turns out we got to find this Marianas Trench. We find all these deep, deep parts. And they had to keep coming up with more bottom names. I think that's my favorite part.
Yeah, no, I agree. I just kind of have this image in my head that, you know, a long time ago, explorers, when they're trying to figure out the depth, they're like, okay, let's let out our line
oh,
and see
yeah.
how long it goes and
exactly.
count the feet. And it just keeps going. Mm-hmm. So kind of, you know, I could just imagine like, okay, well, like bathy, bottom.
Mm-hmm.
And then, oh, no, let's get a longer line. And we go down to this abyss that just keeps going. And then Hades is the god of the underworld, right? So the Hadal Pelagic, they're like, okay, so deep it's going to the underworld now. So, yeah, I agree. It's kind of interesting. It's always actually
helped
me remember,
yeah.
too.
The names are so helpful. And you're absolutely right. That's how deep sea exploration started, was let's put a lead ball on a rope and let's see how much rope we have until it hits the bottom. I mean, that was really the initial exploration. We've come a long way in what we're able to know about the ocean floor and what we're able to map about the ocean floor. But there's still a lot that we don't know. Less than 1%, is that
right.
kind of where we're at, right?
Yeah.
Less than 1% of the deep sea has been explored. That's incredible. That's
like nothing.
That's nothing. That's a huge right. part of our planet, and we know nothing about it.
Which is really interesting. So we're talking about, you know, how originally, like, someone did start to kind of lower their line down and see how deep it was. But we've obviously moved forward, and there's been a lot of information to figure out these depths and that kind of thing. Let's talk about some of that exploration. So skipping down, the first kind of underwater exploration was in 1934.
Right. So the first initial explorations were some manned excursions. So before, you know, first you have the lead line and you're on the boat. And then how do we man a submarine in order to go to explore the deep sea? So some challenges of this exploration are that it's deep, it's dark, it's cold, there's lots of pressure. So designing some submersibles that are going to withstand these very extreme conditions. So in the 30s, there was basically this big steel hollow ball, and some lovely person had the job of going into this steel ball and lowered down, and I think the furthest that they got was about 3,000 feet, which is
that's pretty good,
right?
Especially for the 30s. I mean,
yeah.
So if we can get this full screen, just to kind of give you a good view, this is what that first one looked like. So again, it's basically this big, like, steel ball, and here, right here, would be, like, the window. That their one little peephole. So they would get down there, and, of course, they weren't going very fast. It takes a very long time mm-hmm. to get down to those depths. No bathroom,
no
food, or,
isn't that
well,
incredible?
Maybe some snacks, right?
Yeah, I mean, and if you look at our submersibles today, of course, look very different, but really there's some of this initial design that still exists.
Right.
We need to lower strong containers with people down to the ocean. This was the beginning of sort of these manned submersibles. Some of the manned submersibles that people might be more familiar with now are things like Alvin, right? Alvin
right.
was responsible for finding the Titanic, so Alvin got a lot of press. But even those are really challenging to run. There aren't many of them. It costs a lot of money. $30,000 for one dive of Alvin.
And even that, when this was written, so when we got our information kind of together, this is actually a couple of years old. So mm-hmm. I highly doubt that they could do an excursion for $30,000. Right. Yeah. It's probably much more now.
Yeah, I think actually you're right. I feel like somebody told me 45, which is a huge jump. So I don't know if that number is
more.
I don't know if that number is correct, but that's like sort of coming
to
mind.
A lot of money. Basically.
A lot of money. It's not the only one, but it's definitely the most famous one. And I think that the Alvin now has actually been retired.
Right.
My understanding is that it's been retired.
I heard
there's
that
Alvin 2s and there are other ones. If you're really interested in the most up-to-date explorations that we're doing, I definitely recommend that you look into a ship called the Okeanos Explorer. It's a ship that's funded by NOAA, and it's the first ship that has been commissioned specifically for exploration. So,
which is awesome.
Which is just really neat because there's so much that we don't know. As a NOAA vessel, scientists are able to petition to have their work done on the ship. It goes all over the world. You can track the ship. It is one of the telepresence of the ship is just incredible. So you can not only track the ship, but you can track the data coming off the ship.
So cool.
You can interact with the scientists that are on board. So Okeanos is definitely on the front wave of ocean exploration. So that would be a great.
And I love the interactiveness. That's awesome to even be able to like get involved, because so much of the stuff, you know, when it was first happening was secretive.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like when some of the first excursions were happening, they didn't always tell everybody, you know, because they didn't know if those people were coming back.
Right.
Even on the first one, they didn't expect the people to come back.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't know if they could make it because of first time down there.
Oh, yeah.
So, and again, just kind of talking about that, some kind of cool facts. There are some limitations, right? So
mm-hmm.
it's not like when these things are lowered, they're hooked up to the main generator up on the boat.
Right. So you're limited by battery power. You're limited by manpower. I've never been in one, but from what I hear, it's very close quarters. There's no bathroom. Bring your own lunch. You know, it's kind of a very intense sort of experience, but it has allowed us to make some of our discoveries. And as with any other discovery, we kind of end up asking more questions. What have we learned now that leads us to need more information? And probably the biggest thing that has been realized is that we do have a need for unmanned technology as well. So we have that capability too. We're able to send remotely operated vehicles, or ROVs, into the water to collect data, to collect images, to collect samples even, and that helps us, again, maybe not answer all our questions, but continue to ask better questions.
Yeah, and that means that they can be down there, like you were saying, unmanned, so that means nobody has to go down
mm-hmm.
there in these remotely operated vehicles. So they can go down there and do numerous things. It's not just where with like we would go down in some of them and look around. These ones that are now going down can collect a variety of things like salinity and
mm-hmm.
temperature. They can have one portion down there, one part of a vehicle, just collecting temperature every 5 minutes, or just testing salinity every 5 minutes, or whatever.
And there are a number of different kinds of these ROVs, so they're not sort of just a one-stop shop. If you're looking for collecting benthic samples, like little pieces off the bottom, if you're looking for a longer dive, if you're looking for collecting video, if you're looking for collecting specimens, there are a number of different ROVs or unmanned technology, so it's almost like you have a menu of which one's gonna work best for what we need to collect or for this specific mission. Some of them are, I love ABE because everybody loves that it's called ABE, the Autonomous Benthic Explorer. It looks like a Starship Enterprise.
It totally does.
There are FET, there's one called FETCH, which looks like a torpedo, and it's a side scan sonar. I mean, really, really cool things that allow us to just survey, because at this point, we're just trying to gather information about this habitat and learn more.
Right. And let's get a full screen of this one if we can, please. I would love to just show this just because it looks so different just comparing
mm-hmm.
the one that we saw a few moments ago, the first one down in the 30s, to this one. Obviously, this one is the unmanned. But just amazing what these things can collect and teach us so much about what it's like down there, because we really have no clue. We do know, like you were saying, though, that it is a lot of constants. So kind of jumping into that, let's talk a little bit about what we do know.
Okay.
As far as what's down there. So what would it be like really deep?
So deep sea, kind of the general physical characteristics are it's cold, it's dark, and there's a lot of pressure. And because of all that, we don't see a lot of animals, and we don't have a lot of biomass, meaning there's probably not a lot of huge animals. So the animals that are down there are most likely probably small, and there's not a ton of them. Water temperature is generally low. It can be to about 4 degrees Celsius, and that is right above freezing.
Really
cold. I mean, right above freezing, yeah. Oxygen content is constant and sometimes limiting. So where's the oxygen coming from? There's not that photosynthesis that's producing the oxygen. So down there in the deep sea, it's a challenging, harsh environment, not only for us to explore, but it definitely requires that the animals have some special adaptations for living there. And even the food, I mean, the fact that a lot of the food doesn't even come from there,
right,
is really, really interesting.
So a lot of the food, speaking of, has to come from above, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, when you think about, if there's not that much going on, they're going to have to get their food somewhere. But these deep oceans, something dies, right? It's going to sink. Mm-hmm. And that's where a lot of the food can come with. And we'll get into that a little bit. But one of the things that I heard that was kind of fun and interesting was when they started doing some of the first explorations and they would lower the manned vessels down, that I think it was the first or the second exploration, that when they sat on the bottom, it created this like snow effect almost. Do you want to talk about that, or do you know what I'm talking about?
Well, I've heard of the term marine snow,
right?
And so this idea that the food has to come from above, so this, that when animals are dying, or it has to come from above, so it's this fact that it sort of is snowing down on them. And when an animal, like, I always think about when the blue whale is killed, or a very large whale, but only part of it's eaten by the predator that actually kills it. Does that animal go to waste? No way. It's just incredible how much of it makes its way down to the deep sea, and how animals have become so specialized feeders to make use of that. I mean, wood, bone-eating worms,
right,
you know, just to make use of just everything that's there.
Nothing goes wasted.
Nothing
that's
goes
for
to
sure.
Waste.
So the one of the things that I was talking about, like with all that stuff that like settles to the bottom, right? It's like really soft, really like kind of powdery almost. And when one of these explorations landed, it kicked up this very like kind of soft substrate on the bottom, because it's like the snowy stuff almost. And like talking like, you know, how it falls,
yeah,
and then it just kind of sets nicely. And it came up over the window.
Oh, I had no idea.
And by the time it settled back down, they had to go back up. So just right before as it was coming up, you know, that they'd kind of messed up the bottom substrate there, is where they were able to see some animals. And that was kind of the first idea that, like, oh, there are animals down here. But I mean, there's lots of stuff on the bottom, you know, there's like the fish poop and the scales and all this other stuff that just kind of like, it just reminds me of like soft, mm-hmm, kind of fluffy.
Well, there's probably not as nearly as many decomposers.
Right.
So it just sort of sits there.
Yeah.
I guess I hadn't really thought about that before.
Yeah, definitely. So kind of cool, kind of interesting, right?
Yeah.
Now, one of the other things that we have here that we'll pull up is about the vertical migration. Some of the animals that do live deep will actually come up a little,
yeah,
bit.
So this is another technique. So either you're in the deep sea, there's not a lot there, you have to eat. You either wait for stuff to fall from above, or you go and get it. So there are a number of animals that exhibit this adaptation that we call vertical migration, which means that they avoid predation by living deep enough that their predators can't find them, but they are able to feed by traveling incredibly long lengths towards the surface in order to eat. And what this results in is this movement of biomass from deep layers up closer towards the surface, not to the surface, but closer to the surface, and then back down again. And this was initially kind of a little confusing to scientists, because as we're taking readings to find out what's in the water, the sonar would bounce off of the bladders of these fish specifically, even though that's not a fish. Fish do this a lot. And what they would do is it would bounce off the bladder of the fish, and it would look like, oh, that's the bottom. There's something there. And then you go and take the reading again. Oh, my gosh, now it's deeper. What's happening? And what they discovered was that they were actually getting a reading of these fish that were migrating further towards the surface and then weren't there during the day. So they come up at night, run a marathon, eat some dinner, run a marathon back home.
Right, and I actually did labs on this in college, which I mean,
well,
it wasn't,
you should be talking.
It wasn't deep sea, but I mean, we did test the vertical migration of these animals, and it was just to kind of see. Some actually did a reverse migration, but again, this wasn't deep sea, so a little bit different. But yeah, this idea of animals migrating up and down the column, and we've talked about krill, for example, which is what this picture is up here, up on the screen there. But krill, you know, they, I think of these things that, like, you can't swim against a current, but you'll swim up and down, you know, no problem. So just kind of interesting that these animals are able to recognize those light times and know, oh, time to go down. And then, oh, it's dark. Okay, let's kind of head up. It's like hide and seek time. You know, I'm going to come up there and grab my food and then head back down. So just one of the kind of cool ways to know that these animals have figured that out. I mean, not figured it out, like, they did a mathematical equation.
Not that they're consciously doing it, but over generations that they've been able to do,
To kind of come up with this and be able to survive. I mean, it's just crazy to live in these two totally different environments. So, again, I think that that just helps to bridge that gap between it's not like zone, you're to this zone, you're to that zone. It's all interconnected.
And there's not a hard line. I mean, I think that this trawl is a great way to talk about that. So when you do a trawl, if you were to do a collection at 1,000, 1,500 feet, you might have a prediction or a hypothesis of what you're going to collect. But what if you get something that you had assumed lived a lot deeper? Is that potentially something that is coming up to the surface to feed? And so we have previously done with a teacher institute some of these trawls, and we find animals that a lot of people would consider deep sea. They have adaptations for survival at those depths, but we're getting them maybe a little bit in that middle. So there's not a ceiling, there's not a floor, there's lots of movement in between them.
Right. Mm-hmm. And just some kind of cool info on that, or some stats basically. They say that krill and other pelagic shrimp may travel 800 meters or more. That just is mind-blowing. 800 meters. That's thousands, a couple thousand feet. So the other organisms have well-developed bones and muscles. And of course, again, remembering that they're coming from deep, closer to the surface, that means that there's going to be a temperature change too, right? Mm-hmm. So they have to be able to come or overcome those different temperatures as well. So we've talked about, like, for example, the tide pools and how those animals may have to go through some crazy changes if they're stuck in pools and it gets heated up from the sun or whatever. But I mean, here, it's not that situation, and yet these animals are still having to do this variety of different temperatures and all that kind of stuff. So it's everywhere.
I think we just have, because of there's so much more to know, I think what we really, when we talk about the deep sea, we talk about generalizations, and we talk about, this is what we kind of are predicting, or these are some general physical properties of the environment. These are some characteristics that we expect to see. And same is true for these adaptations. I heard a quote somewhere about if you drag a net at a certain depth, basically you're going to get a whole bunch of jellies, and every 80 to 90% of all animals that you get are going to be bioluminescent. So that's a assumption about most of the animals. We can assume that they're going to be living in these harsh environments. We're going to be assuming these sorts of things. And then the more we learn, the more we know, the better our questions get to be, so that we can really determine what those exceptions are.
Yeah, it's like our exploration drives the question, drives the exploration, drives the question, and so forth. Definitely. Now, real quick, just a reminder, since it's been a little quiet today, if you have any questions, of course, you can write in or call the line. We'd love to hear from you. So hopefully, if you have anything that's on your mind or you want to know, please get in touch with us during the class, because we would love to chat with you about that. All right, so let's jump into some of the animals now.
Yes.
So, you know, we've talked about pressure as being one of the big things that animals have to overcome, and you kind of mentioned a lot of the things are going to be smaller. So we'll talk about invertebrates as one of the primary animals. They're pretty well adapted to living in these harsh environments, right?
Yeah. So we didn't go too much into detail, but everyone has an idea about what pressure is. You dive down and you feel in your ears a little bit of pressure, and you equalize and it gets relieved. Well, imagine going thousands of feet, and basically if we were at 1,000 feet or 1,000 meters, we would be 2.5 inches shorter from the pressure. The pounds per square inch is just incredible. So not a lot of air pockets in any of these animals in the deep sea.
Right.
But these invertebrates are adapted for the deep sea. They don't have any bones. And a lot of the animals are very gelatinous, very soft. And again, very small. And their size allows them to have a reduced need for nutrients and food. There's not a lot of food, so you're not going to see a lot of very active predation. That scene in Finding Nemo when he races all over the place, that would take way too much energy to do. So you're going to have slower animals eating less because of their size.
Definitely. All right, so we have a comment that came in or just now. Kyle, the animals tend to be smaller. What's up with the deep sea gigantism?
Yes, there is that as well. So again, we're talking about in general, a lot of animals are small because there's not a lot of food. But there is the alternate opportunity. If you are ginormous, then that's another way to survive. If you're big, and deep sea gigantism just refers to that animals that we would sort of see on the surface are gigantic and just huge in the deep sea.
An example would be like giant squid.
Giant squid, right? Absolutely.
Giant squid.
So we have Humboldt squid, which are could be about the size of people. We have squid that you would eat for calamari, which are about this big. And then in the deep sea, you have more or less the same animal, but enormous. This giganticism tends to come up anytime you have an isolated ecosystem. So it happens. It's something that happens on islands as well. You end up with this giganticism. So yes, you're right, Kyle. That does happen, and there are examples of incredibly large animals. That's another technique. I think it's less common though. I think most of the animals tend to be smaller.
Right. And real quick, I know we're going to kind of jump off from the animals here just for a second, but I think it's really important that we understand pressure. And kind of, we've talked a little bit about it, that every, 33 feet is one ATM. Mm-hmm. But can you kind of recap that again? I really want to get in detail because
sure.
I think that's huge with one of the things that these animals have to overcome.
Sure. So every about 30 feet, you have another atmosphere of pressure. So right now we're all sitting here and we have one atmosphere of pressure on top of us. When we go down 30 feet, we have that 30 feet adds another atmosphere. So because water is so much denser, so much heavier, 30 feet of water equals one atmosphere of water that's on top of us. So you go down 60 feet, you're at two atmospheres. So every 30 feet, you're adding another atmosphere. What exactly does pressure do? Well, imagine if you're laying flat on the ground and you put a bucket on top of your chest, and then you add a little bit of water, you add a little more, a little more, a little more. You add so much water that you feel the pressure on your chest. What are the challenges that you would then have? It's hard to breathe, it's hard to move. That increased pressure is going to change a lot of your biological functions.
It's important to understand. So, and again, we're talking at 90 feet, us as scuba divers, we don't ever even go to like 200 feet, like
right.
You mentioned, right? I mean, we get down to 100 feet and we've got, we start to face some, there's different types of breathing and mm-hmm. that kind of thing. What about for us, like if we come up too soon, right? Like we end up in a chamber, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about that just as a human, like at 100 feet, what our issues would be.
So if you are whole, if you go underwater and you're breathing, you're scuba diving, if you were to hold your breath as you come up, that air expands. Well, that air doesn't have any more room potentially, so that air can then make its way into your blood. What you now have is a bubble in your blood, and not a good thing because the blood moves all around the body. That bubble potentially goes into your brain, that bubble potentially goes into your leg. You have those challenges. So that's why in order to scuba dive, you need to understand the importance of the science and importance of the safety precautions that you have. But again, this air expanding as you move up in decreased pressure is just one of those pieces of the physiological challenges that we have of being at depth. So these animals that we're talking about, any animals that are going to live in the ocean, have already sort of adapted for some of these pressure concerns. But as you go deeper and deeper and deeper, and the pressure gets more and more intense, it's just incredible how much they have to adapt for that. I mean, we're talking about a postage stamp and putting multiple airplanes worth of weight on one postage stamp size. Just an incredible amount of weight, which is another way of thinking about pressure. It's not the exact same measurement, but it's just one other way of thinking about it.
Yeah, and again, kind of relating that back to why it's been so hard to explore, thinking back to those men, that's why they were the steel. Mm-hmm. They had to withstand that pressure. The glass, even, like on the lookout windows, those are all the things that we have to overcome to explore that. And that's why I just wanted to kind of recap on that pressure again to introduce, because now that we're getting into animals, that's, again, one of the reasons that it's gelatinous animals. They're not going to have those, like, air bladders, because mm-hmm. those are things that they would have to overcome. Like the first one up here, for example, that we had a little while ago, we'll show again, is the helmet jelly. So this is an example of an animal that lives down there that I can kind of see the helmet on there a little bit.
This is actually a great one. One thing that we haven't talked about, we talked about pressure, we talked about cold. We haven't really talked about light too much. I mean, we said that there's not photosynthesis happening down there. But not only is there not photosynthesis because of that light, but we're also losing some colors. So if you remember Roy G. Biv, your best friend who makes up the beautiful rainbow, you know that light, the spectrum of visible light, comes from those different wavelengths. And those wavelengths are absorbed differently in the ocean. The ocean is actually a selective absorber. So we lose those red and orange wavelengths fairly early. Scuba divers can see this. If you go underwater till 80, 90, even, you know, like 100 feet, and you take a red ball with you, it looks red on the surface because the entire spectrum of light is hitting it. It's bouncing into your eye, and you're seeing red. Well, if that red wavelength isn't making it all the way down to the depth, all of a sudden that orange or that red ball doesn't look red anymore. So in the deep sea, what you end up seeing is a lot of animals that use this loss of red in their own coloration. You might say, "You're bright red, jelly, what are you doing? I can see you really easily." Mm-hmm. Well, remember, because that red isn't penetrating, it can't be seen as red. It really comes across as dark blue or even black. This image is allowing us to see the color because a flashlight or some other external light is being
source,
used
right.
so that we can see that color, and that flashlight or that light source is providing the full spectrum of light.
Definitely. And again, I mean, just to kind of recap, because I remember, you know, being in high school and like this whole idea of prisms getting broken up. I'm like, I don't understand what's going on. Wait, why can't I see it? But, you know, you take a prism, right, and you shine it on the ground and you'll see the rainbow. And so it basically splits up all the colors of the sun. So we'll get blue, red, green, Roy G. Biv, essentially. Now that red, as Ali was saying, does not penetrate as deep. So we have this one red wavelength that, or not red, but a bunch of red wavelengths that are penetrating and basically just kind of get absorbed into the water. Remember, water is 800 times more dense than air. So it's absorbing this light. And when you see a color, you see the color because the wavelength is bouncing off, like my blue shirt. The blue wavelength is bouncing off of my shirt, and that's why we see blue. So if these animals are red really far down, there's no red wavelength to bounce off of it. So that's why you can't see that red, even though they are red, like here, or like in the picture, excuse me, there is red pigment, but you need a red wavelength to bounce off of it to see it, which the red wavelengths typically don't make it down there unless we have an external source, mm-hmm. like a flashlight. So just to kind of recap on that, because I remember that always confused me. I just was like,
it is kind of a little.
I need a couple of explanations mm-hmm. of that, and I hope that helps a little bit. But anyway, just to kind of to break that up. Now, real quick, we're going to come back to the animals in just a few minutes, but I do want to take a break right now. When we come back, we'll go back into some more invertebrates and some other animals and cool adaptations and continue on. So we'll take a break here in just a minute, get a drink, get a snack, and then we'll come back. So we'll see you in about 5 minutes.
He's gonna have to end.
Can you blow my whistle, baby?
Hi Taurus, my name is Geneva Miriam Koulibaly. I am the ASI president and also a senior of the year 2013. So I'm here to talk to you about the iGIVE campaign, which is a challenge for us to raise enough money to be able to donate iPads to the library for the iPad loan program. So how to give? You can pick up one of those postcards in the Associated Students Office, in the library, and also in the Office of Alumni Programs. Make sure that you fill out the bag and return it to the Office of Alumni Programs. You can also visit the website online for the Senior Gift Class campaign. If you cannot pay right now, it's totally fine. You have the option to make a pledge by giving your information, your name, and your email to the Office of Alumni Programs, and from then you have 90 days to be able to pay your $20.36. And don't forget, you get the possibility to own that beautiful t-shirt with the year 2013 in the back. Very important for you to know, whatever amount of money that we're able to raise, our alumni will support us and match every cent. So don't forget, we want to leave our legacy, we want to be remembered, and once a Toro, always a Toro.
November 1st through November 28th, El Caballo, the horse in Mexican folk art, Day of the Dead altars, and student showcase in studio art. Mexico celebrates a rich tradition of arte popular that reaches more than 2,000 years into the Mesoamerican past. El Caballo, the horse in Mexican folk art, celebrates this enduring tradition through a variety of ceramics, metalwork, paper art, sculpture, and other works of art. A special Day of the Dead altar installation by Dr. Miguel Dominguez, professor of modern languages, will also be on display, as well as a Day of the Dead altar by the prominent Los Angeles artist, Edith Abeita, and CSUDH alumna artist, Victoria Almeida.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
California State University Dominguez Hills Orthotic and Prosthetic Program is unique among the 11 accredited programs in the United States. Cal State program emphasizes heavily clinical input. All the schools are kind of shifting towards a theory-based practice, where the school here is showing that theory base and showing the clinical applications, but we do it in a manner on patient models. We have 15 projects in prosthetics and 16 projects in orthotics with actual live patient models, which is either double or triple some of the other schools out there. So we do a lot more hands-on, a lot more fabrication end of it. So not only learning why we're making the devices, but we also learn how we're making the devices. So keep that technical input into the program. So that really makes our program unique amongst the other schools. For students looking to get into this field and find out a little bit more about prosthetics and orthotics, there's a few different resources for them. The National Commission of Orthotic and Prosthetic Education, NCOPE.org, has a great website to get some more information on. And we do have a specific website for careers in orthotics and prosthetics that goes through how you become a practitioner, how you can implement your skills, and then learn about the various schools and what they offer. And that's opcareers.org. So opcareers.org. It's a great website to get more information on that. Our site, calstatedominguezhills.edu.
Hi, my name is Mark Darcy. I'm a student at CSUDH, and I'm in the Orthotics and Prosthetics program. I love this program, I enjoy it, and this is my dream.
Teatro Dominguez is a multicultural theater company here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. And the program is designed to do play readings, workshops, and folk tale tours to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment. We're doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So for instance, Teatro would do a play reading of a play about assimilating into American culture if you're an Asian immigrant. And that may be performed in a middle school or here on campus. I've had a number of teachers ask Teatro Dominguez to come into their classrooms to read scenes. We have workshops where we would bring a group like Culture Clash in or Cornerstone Theater Company to help our students learn about community-based theater creation. And the touring show is always interesting. Every year we take folktale or we create a folktale of our own, which is animals talking in masks, and we tour it to local second grade classrooms. So what Teatro does is really educational theater. It is theater that focuses on social issues, and it has more of a direct purpose for society.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, welcome back. So we were talking about the helmet jelly, and now let's jump in. We have a really cool video of, actually, if we can back up real quick, let's go to the deep sea invertebrates. I'm gonna pull that back up again, just to kind of show some of the animals we're gonna be talking about. Now, keep in mind, too, that this one picture of all of the invertebrates is just like a very small surface of the amount of animals that can be found down there. Can we get this full, there we go. So you can see some of these animals here. We were talking about this one originally. And I'm going to show you a video on some of the other ones, like this guy here. So there's sponges, there's coral, there's invertebrates. We've got the jellies, the Dumbo octopus, which is just, to me, adorable, is what we have a video. I think it's the Dumbo octopus that we have a video of, which, I just kicked the thing and I'm sinking. But the Dumbo octopus, we've talked about this before, not in this class, but is white. So it's kind of interesting, right? And I have no idea why he's white versus other colors, but let's go ahead and show the video of the octopus here, just because it's kind of cool. Now, these guys don't propel the same, right?
No, so these guys don't propel themselves the way sort of more pelagic cephalopods do. Those guys jet propel. They take in water into their mantle and then shoot it out the siphon. These guys don't really do that. And again, it's just one of those differences of deep sea and needing to move quickly versus not needing to move that quickly. Instead, they just sort of use their large ear flaps, which obviously are not really ears, but just sort of fins, and sort of bop around a little bit.
So it's pretty cool. So if we can get that video up, we'll be able to show you that a little bit. They move around a little, there they go, move around a little bit differently. And as you can see here, white. Now, might not obviously be seen as easily without the light. Remember, there's not light down here. There's zero light waves. So even, you know, being white, even the other animals that are down there are not really well adapted at seeing. Mm-hmm. So even though he is white, he probably wouldn't be seen, right?
Yeah, and as a cephalopod, is he able to camouflage? Does he have the chromatophore cells that he might be able to camouflage?
I'm not sure. That's a great question. Yeah, I wonder,
yeah,
right?
I guess I haven't really seen footage of them changing nearly as quickly or as well as other ones.
And you can see there up on the top, those little like ear flaps.
Which are their fins,
right,
basically.
Kind of moving him around, so kind of cool.
And again, these guys, you know, there's not, even though you see things moving through the water, you see that little marine snow moving around, there's not a ton of current down there. There may be some, but there's not a ton of movement of water. So even his little movement with his little fins is able to move him through. But it is interesting that he doesn't require that that jet propulsion that the other ones do. And again, that's probably just a way you don't want to have any of those air pockets inside of you. So it probably just allows them to be better adapted for the pressure.
Just so cool looking. I love watching his little, it makes sense, Dumbo, right? Mm-hmm. He's using his little ear flaps there to kind of move him around. But I definitely love the way he looks. He's just so cute. So anyway, that is the Dumbo octopus. So there are other animals. We've talked about coral a couple of times mm-hmm. this semester. Coral can live in deep sea.
Yeah, and I think that's really surprising to people because you probably, when you talked about coral, talked about the symbiotic relationship that they have with algae and how that algae produces, does photosynthesis and produces most of the nutrients for its host, the coral. So how in the world could we have deep sea corals? And it's really neat. They don't have that zooxanthellae. They don't require that symbiotic relationship, but they're able to eat the marine snow. They're able to filter feed the food that's in the water. And I think that that Dumbo octopus footage was a great example of mm-hmm. sort of the stuff in the water, and that's the primary food source for a lot of these animals. Again, not a ridiculous amount of animals, but enough food source. So you do have a lot of those filter feeders, and you do have these deep sea corals, which are really incredible,
right?
Because we don't usually think of them as being able to live in these environments. Because the water is so cold and because the area is so constant, again, we have a lot of those very long-living animals. That's another characteristic that you often see of some of those invertebrates, they're very long-living. For those corals, that would be a good example.
Now, speaking of like symbiotic relationships, we also have another little video here we're going to play in a second, and it's an amphipod with a salp. Mm-hmm. And a salp kind of looks like a jelly, but it's not a jelly at all, right?
No, it's not a jelly. Interestingly enough, that salp, that gelatinous animal, and we do have, there are shallow water salps. Those salps are a urochordate. So they're not exactly an invertebrate, but they are more closely related to all vertebrates
right.
Than you would expect. But it really just looks kind of like a really solid plasticky case.
Right,
but
that's kind of what we're seeing here. Mm-hmm. So just a few moments ago, we saw the amphipod, and now the amphipod has kind of embedded in the salp, and that's basically what we were looking at. So they can be a little bit parasitic. Now, one of the things to point out too, isopod versus amphipod, right? I like to think, because we have isopods, deep sea isopods, mm-hmm. and those are kind of like roly-polies.
Yeah, actually, you know, that's a really great example of the deep sea giganticism, come to think of it. That one's for you, Kyle.
Oh, hold on just a second. We don't need the comb jelly just yet.
Isopods. So roly-polies, the guys that you see in the garden, even at the aquarium, in fact, we have a giant isopod. I mean, and it is huge. It's like this big, and it looks exactly like the tiny little guy that you'd see in your yard, but it's this big. And so, like Kyle said before, we do have this possibility of deep sea giganticism where animals exhibit very large size in order to live in these habitats.
And some of the ways to remember, like for example, because we've talked about amphipods and isopods. Amphipods, like we just saw, are kind of squished like this. So they're kind of like skinny up and down, whereas the amphipod, like we were just talking about the roly-poly, was smushed. Or I'm sorry, yeah, isopod. Is smushed like from the top. Mm-hmm. So you step right on an isopod and you smush an amphipod.
Yeah, I had a friend who used to say amphipod, isopod, copepod.
Right, like so dorky, right?
Super, yeah, like A, whatever.
Yes. But anyway, super, super fun little things. So anyway,
it helped me remember. Put it on the test. See if you get it.
I know. I'll probably never forget it either. Now that you've said that.
I'm just saying.
So here's another picture of the deep sea amphipod. And again, that was the one that had, embedded in that salt is a parasitic relationship.
So this guy's kind of interesting. If you look at him, you know, he's sort of that clear look to him. You know, he has all of those body parts and appendages that make him look like all his arthropod friends. But one thing that sometimes a lot of these guys have is, we talked about red coloration, and you do see that a lot in some of these deep sea arthropods. You also sometimes see that their stomachs are red, which we identified with the jelly. But why would just their stomachs want to be red? Good question. If they're eating things, you don't want to be kind of given away. You don't want your predators to see you because you just ate something, especially if that thing is glowing, because that's one of the ways that it might have tried to protect itself. So sometimes we see that their stomachs are coated or black or even red. We don't see it specifically on this one, but I did want to bring it up because this guy's all the way clear. He's kind of clear throughout. So if he were to eat something that were to have some color or light to it, it might present a little bit of a challenge for him.
Right. Yeah, that's a great thing to point up. I'm wondering, should we watch the clip again just to see the red? Want to try and see it?
Sure.
Can we pull up that clip again of the salt and the, it's clip number two. If we can pull that up again, not this one, the one right before it. So the one that we saw just.
Oh yeah, that was a good one because that amphipod, right. Yeah, that's a great idea.
So the other clip that we saw just a few moments ago. Yeah, this is the one. So great. Pointing it out again, there's our salt. There he is. I was going to say,
there he is. Okay, so yeah, in this picture, you can see that the amphipod, it looks like, again, very clear, but that some of his organs on the inside are red.
Right.
And what's the benefit of that is that it sort of acts as a camouflage a little bit. So that's good. I'm glad that we brought that back out.
Yeah, that was the perfect time to talk about that. Yeah, so that clear being a sense of camouflage, right? I mean, you basically are going to blend in with everything that is around you. So now before we play that clip that we started to play a second ago, on the jellies, those are kind of interesting too, right? Let's talk about that before we show the clip.
Sure. So the next animal that we're going to look at looks very much like a true jelly, but it's actually an entirely different phylum. It is called a comb jelly, and it's in the phylum Tenophore, and it's not a true jelly or not a cnidarian, which you covered before, because it doesn't have stinging cells. That's not how it captures its food. It's called a comb jelly because running down the sides of its body are these little combs, basically, and they move the water so quickly that it breaks the light. So like Kira was saying before, Roy G. Biv, the visible spectrum of light, when you put the prism down, it breaks the light and you can see the red and the orange, all of the spectrum that makes white light. The combs on the comb jelly move so quickly that it acts like a prism. It's gorgeous, and I'm really glad that we have these at the aquarium from time to time, and I think right now we do have them on exhibit. So these comb jellies, if we can show that clip, these are another example, very common in the deep sea. And again, I just want to remind you, as we are about to talk about bioluminescence, which is something that people often think of with the deep sea. This is not bioluminescence. This is not the animal producing its own light. It's the animal breaking or refracting the light so that it shows all those different colors.
Yeah.
Very, very cool.
That's one of my favorite talking points when they are on exhibit. It's the same thing. People think that they're making that light. And I'm like, no, it's not quite like that. But there are animals that do actually make light, which we're going to talk about in just a few minutes. So let's go ahead and jump into fish, right? Okay. Because there are fish that do live down deep, and they have to overcome a lot of different things, as we've already been talking about. So are, what about the fish? Big, small?
Most of them are small. And when we say small, we mean like 10 centimeters. So like small, very small. Definitely, 10 centimeters is very small. Are there any that get bigger? Yes, absolutely. Why exactly do they do that? We don't know 100%. Most likely it is an adaptive measure, again, to avoid predation. The challenge of being really big, though, is that you have to eat a lot, which means you have to find that food. Basically, in the deep sea, if two animals come across each other and they're not making babies, somebody's getting eaten.
Definitely.
That's what I like to think about the deep sea.
Yeah. I mean, 5% of the food comes from the surface that will make it down to the deep sea. So that's very, very little. And they have to be adapted, again, maybe in kind of the size thing, like you said, is to being a smaller thing, so you don't have to eat as much, mm-hmm. since it is going to be pretty scarce. The animals, in a video we're going to show in a couple of minutes, their swimming is even different, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, so they're moving fairly slowly. They're kind of sluggish, again, because they don't have a ton of food. Some of them have bigger stomachs. A lot of them have bigger mouths. I mean, even on this hatchet fish, you can see that he has a really large mouth. We will be able to see in a couple minutes some mouths that even can unhinge and get even bigger. So again, they want to have as many weapons in their arsenal so that if they find an animal, they hopefully are going to be doing the eating and not getting eaten.
And they can definitely be sluggish, and one of the big reasons is that pressure. Again, mm-hmm. I mean, you've got all this pressure on top of them, so they're not going to be able to move quickly. We've talked a lot about other predators, like in the epipelagic, like barracuda, for example. They're like ambush predators. They're halibut ambush predator. They lurch out fast. They get their prey. Tuna swim fast. Shark swim mm-hmm. fast. Dolphin swim fast. You know, and we've got these guys down here that it's like,
no, not going anywhere.
Not
going
to happen. Mm-hmm. Yeah, not going to happen. They definitely have to swim in that kind of pressure. And in the video we'll see here in a few minutes, you can really see that they do a lot of swimming with their pectorals, and it's almost like they're like flapping.
Right.
It just makes me out of breath. I'm just like,
I mean, it's a really inefficient way. Using pectoral fins is an incredibly inefficient way to swim because it's like front wheel drive. It's not the most bang for your buck in terms of energy. It is good. I mean, we think about Nemo swimming with his little special fin. Yeah, it's really good at kind of making fine little adjustments. But when we look at any fast animal, they're going to be pushed from behind with that larger muscle. These guys just don't have enough. There's just not enough force to move them. So maybe we should show that.
Yeah,
let's show that clip.
Yeah, DVD. It'll be clip number 4. So this actually has to do with one of the angler fish. Here we go, which we're going to talk about his mouth in a second, so pay attention to that.
So this guy is just a quintessential deep sea fish. And when people think of, ooh, those crazy, weird, alien-looking guys from the deep sea, that's sort of what they think of. They think of the really big mouths. But this is a great, look at those pectoral fins just working overtime. The huge mouth, and again, we mentioned why they have that huge mouth. And that's great footage of how quickly they have to move. What color is that shrimp? Red.
Deep red. It deep almost looks
red.
Like it was like enhanced
or something.
It was
like a flash.
Yeah.
Of red. That was really cool. Yeah.
So
he actually moved pretty quickly, which is...
Right.
Yeah.
Right. But I mean, just like when he's just like, I'm like, mm-hmm. oh God, I want to like cough and take in a deep breath from or something. Like, seems just so strenuous. So speaking of their mouths, their teeth there were really unique. I mean, mm-hmm. those things are huge.
Right. So you see those big teeth and you think they must use those to eat very large animals. And that's really not the design or the intention behind those. They sort of act like a jail cell. So those animals with very large teeth have a huge mouth. They need that huge mouth in order to eat animals that are potentially as big as themselves, if not bigger. That also means that their stomach has to be that large to take in that much biomass. But those teeth sort of act like a jail cell, so they can trap animals. So even if the first snap doesn't pierce them, it catches them, and it keeps them in there so that they can eat them. Which is really important because, again, those interactions are few and far between. They have to eat whatever they can.
Right.
This guy also has those big teeth. I mean, you often have those big teeth and really, really big mouths.
If we can pull this full screen, you can kind of see the comparison here, too. This is a great example. This is the bristle mouth. And again, like Ali was saying, I mean, you can see that they just have those teeth that are definitely meant for trapping and really, really helpful in catching their food.
I just want to point out one other thing on that bristle mouth. On his bottom side, and we're going to talk about this in a couple minutes, but this is just such a great picture to show that all those photophores, all those dots along the edge, all of those guys are the photophores where a little bit of light is coming off of. So we'll talk in a few minutes about how he's only on the bottom, but that's a really great example of it right there.
Perfect. So another thing too, kind of going back, if we can pull back up the picture of the hatchet fish, their mouths, right, are pointed up.
Yeah, that's a great point. Their food is going to come from above, so their mouths are going to be pointed up. That's a really good point. So big mouths, often with very large teeth, pointed up, being able to eat whatever they can, and again, those hinged or unhingeable jaws where they can unhinge their jaw and again eat things that are just as large as them, if not bigger.
And that hatchet fish is a perfect example. I don't know if you saw on the bottom, but it's 8.4 centimeters.
Mm-hmm.
That's so small.
That is just this little guy.
Itty bitty little dude. All right, another thing too, looking at his eye, right?
Yeah.
His eye is a perfect example of some of the other adaptations, right?
Yeah, so this eye is a really large eye, and I think people would often imagine that again for the deep sea, but really that is just a characteristic of the mesopelagic, that middle twilight zone. They have large eyes so that they can make the best use of whatever light there is. As you get into the midnight zone where there's no light, it's much more common to see extremely tiny eyes, if at all any eyes to be seen at all.
Pull up the big mouth, big eyes photo? I think that'll be a good
good to
show here too.
Because I think people always think that they have to have big eyes. Mm-hmm. But again, that big eye is going to be a characteristic of living in that mesopelagic, that twilight zone where there's a little bit of light. So if you see a deep sea fish, and you can kind of guess, all right, does he have a big eye? Does he have this big jaw? He's most likely living in the middle. If he's living in the middle, also that means he's going to be traveling a lot more. The animals that live way down in the bathypelagic, it's so far they're not going to be doing that vertical migration.
And it's almost like same thing, like little eyes, right? I mean, the eyes tell so much. I kind of feel like you have animals that live in the epipelagic or more like really at the surface, they're not going to have necessarily huge eyes either, right?
Right?
Mm-hmm. I think of
they
like,
don't need it.
Right, they don't need it. There's lots of light. But then you get down to like that middle area where there is like that kind of middle, there's just a little bit of light, so they need big old eyes. But then when you go even further down, you go back down to those smaller eyes because they're not going to really
you
do
you just don't need it. It's a waste of energy for the organism to develop that eye when it's just not being used.
Right. Now, there are, as we've been talking about and we'll really get into right now, there are animals that do produce light, which we call bioluminescence, and there's lots of different forms. And Ali, I think I share your enthusiasm, but she's definitely excited to talk all about these different types of bioluminescence, because we think of bioluminescence, which means like living light, right? And you think, oh, okay, well, some animals can light up, but there's actually much more to it than that.
Yeah, there's much more to it. You know, and this photo is actually even a great example for bioluminescence, because right behind the eye is that little spot right there. You know, there's even different kinds of bioluminescence. So most of these animals use bioluminescence for some purpose, whether it's to catch prey, whether it's to communicate, whether it's to ward off predators. Basically anything that these animals need to do, most likely they're using bioluminescence in order to do. We mentioned before on that bristle mouth that the bottom of it had all those little photophores. Photophores are the spot where light is being produced. Now, this bioluminescence is a chemical reaction. I think that that's a really important point. It's bioluminescence, meaning it's living light, but the reaction that's causing the light is actually a chemical reaction. And if you've ever cracked open a glow stick and give it a shake, that's the same kind of thing. In the presence of oxygen, this chemical reaction is happening, producing the light.
Absolutely. And I like to really point out the difference too between like our light bulb, mm-hmm. right, that's giving off light versus this type of light. Because when we give off our light bulb, like you go to undo a light bulb and it, you just turn it off, it's hot. Mm-hmm. So a lot of the energy into producing that light is actually giving off heat. And a little percentage is given off light, but that's totally opposite with this.
Yeah, so this is such a great point, because if you think of any light, there is heat associated with it. Even with the CFC bulbs versus the incandescent bulbs, there might be less heat related to it, and that's why it's a more efficient energy use. But I mean, everything from your projector, the TV, if there's light being emitted, there's also heat being emitted. And with this, there is not. We call it a cold light because it's a much more efficient use of the energy, and it's all going towards emitting the light. Now, it is this chemical reaction, but I think it's a great point to also remind people that there are little bacteria that are in these photophores that are helping with this chemical reaction. So the fish isn't consciously saying, okay, I want to produce light now, or doing anything like that. There is sort of a symbiotic relationship happening in those photophores where the bacteria is helping to produce the light.
Definitely. Now, one of the things I wanted to talk about too is that this is pretty common in animals, right?
Oh, yeah.
So it's 90%, this is 90% of species of crustaceans, excuse me, zooplankton, fish, and squid emit light. That's insane. Mm-hmm. 90%?
And you don't even have to go to the deep sea in order to see it. We can see it phytoplankton bioluminesce right on the surface. If you have a really clear moonless night and you're at the surface of the water and you move the water around, you'll see bioluminescence being produced by the phytoplankton that's right at the surface.
So you just a little shake of the hand. Mm-hmm. Some people say, like, if you're on a boat, go to the back of the boat if it's a really dark night. The propellers will be stirring mm-hmm. it up, or sometimes even like we have algal blooms, mm-hmm. we'll get like the waves that crash, and it's just this totally iridescent.
Yeah, I mean, even the wave crashing on the beach, and then you move the sand, and you can see the bioluminescence in the sand.
So
very,
it's there.
Very cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's there.
If you've ever done a night snorkel, that's also a pretty good time. You get down a little bit, do a little shake of the water, and you'll have little glowy things going on around you.
So we said that these guys use bioluminescence in order to communicate in some way, whether they're trying to attract a mate, whether they're trying to lure prey, they're trying to appear larger to defend themselves against their own prey, or they're trying to camouflage, actually. And this is a really interesting one. Because there's not a lot of light, because there is no light, really, down there, this is the main source of light, this idea of counter-illumination, where an animal will only be illuminated on the ventral side or on the bottom of its body. It's very similar to a great white shark. So a great white shark is gray on top, white on the bottom. That's called counter shading. If you were above the shark, it would look dark when you look down. If you were below the shark, it would look light and would sort of blend in with the light coming from above. This is the same idea, except instead of white, it's actually illuminated. So this is much more common in that middle zone. Again, you wouldn't really see this in the mesopelagic zone because, again, just really not enough light to really mimic at all. So we have this really cool picture of a fish called a midshipman. Midshipman is a fish that we sometimes see in those trawls, and they do a little bit of migrating and moving, but they're a great example of one of these counter-illumination, and unfortunately it's actually not a great picture of the counter-illumination underneath, but if you are looking down from above, you don't see any light. Actually, the hatchetfish might be a really good example of this,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, let me write that down. I'm going to write that down just because that way we can get...
the hatchetfish and the bristlemouth, too.
Right. Mm-hmm. If you can bring the hatchetfish back up for us, please, that would be a perfect... example, we'll go back because you could really see it down there on the mm-hmm. bottom. So back up to the beginning, if you could please, before the DVD clip, it was the hatchetfish. There
yeah,
we go.
That's a great one. So you can really see those photophores down there. And again, just limited to the bottom so that an organism from below would see some light, organism from above. So this hatchetfish is a great classic example of that midnight level, big eye, big mouth, photophores on the bottom, very small body, you got yourself a mesopelagic fish.
Definitely. All right, so again, pointing this out, when we talked about that the amphipod, right, that had the red stomach, if they were to eat something, that was glowing, then mm-hmm. that would then bring attention to them. Mm-hmm. So they're kind of like, oh, well, not good, right? And that's actually also in addition to one of the things that bioluminescent animals also use to their advantage is kind of like, well, eat me, and now you're going to be glowing.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends on the animal. Like the animals that can get away with that, you know, that have adapted to having that kind of fixed stomach, they're able to eat those bioluminescent animals, but that might prevent others from eating the bioluminescent animals because it might make them, in return, glow.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the ideas. All right, so let's move on real quick. Let's touch on reproduction. That's not going to be an easy task down there, right?
Right, exactly. So no Match.com, no Facebook, really difficult to find a mate. So one way that fish sort of increase their chances of passing on their genes is many of them are hermaphroditic, which means that they're able to produce both. They have male and female gonads, so they're able to produce both, which basically means that they're increasing their chances that their genes are going to get passed on. But finding a mate can be difficult, so again, the bioluminescence, pheromones, some different ways of finding each other in this vastness of the deep sea.
Which is just kind of cool that's how it works, that not a mate, fine, I'll be mm-hmm. my own.
Well, another thing that they do is the anglerfish is a great, yeah, I'll be my own. You don't want to do that. You don't want too much of that self-fertilization because then you want some branches in your family tree. But the anglerfish has a great way of dealing with this challenge. And the way they do it is once they find a mate, you just don't let them go.
Yeah.
This is a picture of the female anglerfish. Anglerfish are known for using the bright lure to mm-hmm. pull in their prey. They have those really huge mouth pointing up with the big teeth. This is the female. This is actually a relatively large fish for the deep sea. The males, however, are very small. And what happens is the males will bite onto the females and become part of her system. So she pumps blood, she eats, she does all the work, she does all the housework, she cleans, she does the dishes. And all the male has to do is basically be a sperm factory. But it's beneficial for the female because then she's able to reproduce whenever she's ready to.
So they both gain on that.
They both kind of gain.
All right. So real quick, we're going to wrap up today with hydrothermal vents and cold seeps. Now, this, as Allie and I were mentioning, is a very interesting topic. What are hydrothermal vents?
So hydrothermal vents are these very unique communities that were discovered back in about 1977. So a lot of people think that science is done, it's complete, it's in a textbook, there's nothing new under the sun. This is absolutely not true. So the discovery of these vents was this brand new community and also sort of a brand new way of looking at food webs. When we talk about food webs and food chains, we always start with the sun as the initial source of energy. The energy from the sun is used by plants through photosynthesis, and then plants are the base of all food webs. This is not true when we talk about these hydrothermal vent communities. Basically, at the cracks of the surf of the crust, the Earth's crust, they're so thin, and underneath is this very hot, so close to the magma underneath that the magma heats up this water and creates these black smokers. So in this picture, you can see this smoke, it sort of looks like steam, coming out from underneath. So the seawater trickles down through the cracks in the crust. It's heated up to these incredibly high temperatures and emerges through the vents. Now again, the pressure at these locations is actually incredibly important to the creation of the vents. It allows these big plumes to go up. And the water has sulfides inside of it. And those sulfide minerals are able to be processed. And so those sulfides, rather than photosynthesis, those sulfides are the base of the food webs. We call this chemosynthesis instead of photosynthesis. So rather than generating food from sunlight, you're generating food from the sulfides. And the animals that are able to take those sulfides and produce food are these tube worms.
Which amazing.
Amazing.
Love the tube.
Amazing tube worms.
We actually have a really cool video. Real quick, yeah, let's take a look at this photo if we can bring it full screen. We'll show you these tube worms, and then we'll show you a video taken of these hydrothermal vents and kind of everything that's going on around that area.
So the really cool, one of the there are so many cool things about these tube worms, but one amazing thing is that they are so large. And if you want to go ahead and show the video, I'll just keep talking. Those red plumes are what's able to pull in the sulfides. Now these plumes, these tube worms can be like 10 feet tall. And the communities are able to live at these black smokers because there's actively this heat coming up. One of the interesting things about these communities, though, is that they don't last very long. Because those plates are constantly moving, if there is the loss of the black smoker, if it is no longer producing those big plumes, the tube worms are not able to make their food, and then all of the animals that then live in the community are not able to survive. So what do we have in these communities? We have crabs, we have snails, we have little sea stars. Lots of animals that, again, are able to live in these very unique environments just because of that interaction between the salt water, the pressure, and the magma that is just under the Earth's
And just pointing out too, I mean, remember that we're talking about extremely cold water surrounding this area. We talked about it being 4 degrees Celsius, and we've got like potentially what under normal circumstances at, you know, sea level would be boiling water, right?
I mean, that's a great point.
Extremely, extremely hot water. So I can only imagine what it would be like to be an animal that all of a sudden your hydrothermal vent is no longer there, that normally lives in this super hot water, and bam, you're in cold water.
And there are even some little crabs that are called Yeti crabs because they look like little Yetis, really, basically. And they put their arms over the hydrothermal vent. So potentially part of their body is in 4 degree water while their arms are in really, really hot water getting whatever sulfides out that they can. Incredible communities.
Yeah, I mean, and that's another thing. I mean, that just so much can be learned about them. I think every class I always point out, if this interests you, then you could look into this as being a scientist and studying specifically hydrothermal vents, or even more specifically, the crabs that live in the hydrothermal vents, or whatever. I mean,
so many animals still to be discovered.
Exactly,
so much. And
exactly.
The fact that scientists go back and then it's moved potentially because of plate tectonics moving, that these communities have been moving as well.
Definitely.
Really interesting.
All right, so that just about wraps up our class for today. So hopefully you've gained a lot. We didn't have too much activity going on. So if you have any questions, feel free to email me. I will be happy to answer those for you. I will have the quiz and the discussion board up. I'm going to go back to the aquarium, try and get those up for you today. And then you'll, of course, have until next week. So again, your final exam will be at the end of the semester, December 4th. It will open up. You will have the following week to finish your final exam and do our last quiz. So again, that last week is always a little bit busy, so just be prepared for that. And December 4th at 11:59 that night, your conservation paper is due. So please make sure you follow all the instructions for that. Again, email me if you have any questions. And hope everybody has a wonderful Thanksgiving. Thank you for being with us, and I will see you next Tuesday.